Anyone else? Quickly. Yes. All right. Debbie Calloway is asking prayer for her niece, her sister's daughter, Jeannie, or Gigi, a lot of people call her. And she has been diagnosed with cancer, and we want to pray for her. She's having surgery this week. Anyone else? I have several announcements to make, and then we are going to have someone. April Bell is going to come. April, where are you? Come on up, and we're going to do this fairly quickly. Number one, Restoration House. April represents Restoration House, Crisis Pregnancy Center in Hammond, and she's going to share some things with us. We are going to do, I think, the baby bottle collection for money again, and I want to give her an opportunity to share a little bit about that with you. So it's yours. Thank you for being here.
Hi. Thank you all so much for letting me get up and speak. It's always a pleasure to come meet folks that are interested in what we do at Restoration House and want to help out. I've been with Restoration House about 18 years. I started when my daughter was a baby. She's 19 now with her own baby. I just had a heart for ladies, and I love pregnancy and babies. And so it's a perfect place for me. And I've been there off and on, done lots of jobs there. And what we do, we're a crisis pregnancy center. We don't just do free pregnancy tests. We also do ultrasound. We help with baby things from newborn to 4T, anything you would need for a young child. We also counsel women who are contemplating abortion, thinking about it, unsure what they want to do. And we try to talk them out of that decision because it affects your life in every area. So that's our main focus and our goal. We also have Bible study classes. We share the gospel. We also have GED classes. We always need help as far as volunteers, if you want to come. I started sorting baby things in the baby closet because I didn't want to talk to people. And now I talk to people, lots of people. But I also encourage you, if you want to come for a tour to see our facility and what we do there, meet some of our volunteers and employees. We also need finances. The baby bottle campaign is an easy way to do that. You bring home a bottle. Kids love it because they're like, oh, I found a penny. Let me put it in the bottle. You can fill it with change. We also like cash and checks, too, because that adds to it. It's about $25 on average per bottle. So it's our second biggest fundraiser next to our banquet. We usually raise $10,000 to $15,000 in a year just with change. So if you have any questions, I'll be in the back after service. And we have the bottles back there. Thank you.
Thank you. So they have a table set up as you go through the foyer on the left. And they'll be glad to talk to you. They have bottles available. And what a great ministry that is. I remember from 20-some plus years ago, I can't tell you all the story that I want to tell you, but I know a girl who is now about 20 years old that was not aborted. And she has a wonderful life. And we praise God for the work that's done there. We need help, guys, ladies. Men, we need help. You sit in a chair every Sunday morning. Somebody has to put that chair out. Two men have been doing most of the putting out. Now, you're awesome at picking them up, and we get it done pretty quickly. But we need help, and so we need you to sign up. If we get four teams, you can come basically once a month and help. But if you receive blessing from being a part of our church and sitting in a nice chair, then we need you to take responsibility to help make those chairs available if you're physically able to do that. So there's a sign-up list. Last Sunday we had that. I announced it, and we had one person sign. There's the sign-up, and then there's the draft. So don't make me institute the draft. Please do. We have a discovery luncheon on Sunday, the 16th of February, that follows our worship gathering, and you will see on the reverse side of the connection card a place to sign up for that. Be in prayer about revival, children's revival coming up. This is not just for children, but we want to emphasize families with children and be thinking about and cultivating people to bring. Brandon is a great communicator, not just with children, but with adults. But at camp, when he does the children's messages, the kids just love him. And the adults are like, why can't you preach like that? He is good. So that's coming up. If you have your bulletin, you're a guest today, please take a yellow card out, share some information with us, and put that on the offering plate or hand it to me or one of the other staff members before you leave. After I pray in a moment, after our beginning of our worship service, after all of our services over, the special needs banquet volunteers need to meet with Kathy Hayden immediately afterward. And Kathy, I'm looking to see where you are. There you are. So why don't we say meet in this corner over here. Special need volunteers for the special need banquet that's coming up. Meet with Kathy afterwards. All right? We have a lot of prayer concerns. We want to pray for Gigi. There are a lot of other burdens. God's answered a lot of prayers. Jesus said, my house will always be a what? A house of prayer. Have you ever thought about what a privilege it is to be able to talk to God and to pour your heart out and to find in him someone who is not reluctant to answer prayers, but who is eager to answer prayers that his children pray. Let's go to him in prayer. Father God, you are so good. You have been so good to us, Lord. You love to answer our prayers. Thank you for the praise that Stacy shared. And Lord, we thank you. I thank you for Gigi, for Debbie's niece, and for her mom, her dad. God, I pray in the name of Jesus you would have mercy on her, that you would continue to reveal the healing power of Jesus through her life. God, I pray that you would bless Restoration House, and that thousands of innocent lives could be saved because of their ministry, and lives could be turned to Jesus rather than to the world's ways because of their ministry. Bless them. We just commit this time together. Thank you this morning that we have a dry place to meet. Thank you that we have a place that is pleasing, and that you promised that you would meet with us, Lord, if we gathered in the name of Jesus. And so we declare that we have gathered this morning in the name of Jesus Christ for his glory. And we ask you, Holy Spirit of God, to move among us and draw people to the fullness of Christ. Point to him and let everything that's said and done point to the glory of Jesus Christ. In his name we pray. Amen.
Let's stand as we worship and sing, This is Amazing Grace.
Power of sin and darkness. destined to die, poured out for all mankind. God's only Son, perfect and spotless one. He never sinned, suffered as he
if you can, if you're physically able and you can where you are, just bow your knee to the Lord. The word for worship is to prostrate yourself. Many can't do that and understand. Just sit down. Let's tell God thank you for the cross. Let's tell God thank you for bowing down and condescending, lowering himself. And Jesus, Lord, we thank you. You to whom all glory and praise throughout all of creation and eternity belongs, that you bowed down your knee in the Garden of Gethsemane. You fell on your face and worshiped your God, and you gave yourself to die on that cross for us so that we might be able to worship God and know Him as our Father, so that our sins could be forgiven and you could transform our lives. We desire this morning to give you the glory that your name is due. And so we say thank you, Jesus. Praise Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. If you love Jesus and you're able to speak those words, just silently or out loud, just say praise Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Thank you. Lord, we give this time of looking in your word and our singing to you, and we pray that Jesus' name might be glorified and that people might be brought to this cross and find life this morning here in this place. In his name we pray. Amen. I'm going to deviate this morning from what I had planned to preach in the Gospel of Luke. I had an experience yesterday, and I want to be careful to say that all glory belongs to Jesus. And so if I tell you a story and in that story I say something about what I did or what I said or what I shared, I really mean what God allowed me to do, what God prompted me to do, what the transforming power of the cross of Christ accomplished. I have a sty in my eye, so if you're looking at my eye and you're thinking, boy, that looks weird, Debbie did not hit me. She probably should have, but she didn't. And it's a lot better now than it was 2 days ago. And so if tears are in my eyes, I'm going to blame it on the sty. Friday morning, I drove to Alabama, try to see my mom. I feel an urgency to go more often than I have in the past because I don't think she'll be here a long time. And I see her ability to remember me as being deteriorating. And that's okay, that's how life is. I'm grateful that I remember her and I have so much of who she is in me. So much of what she did for me and my sisters and my family. I saw her, I saw my sister and brother-in-law. And then I got up early yesterday morning and drove down to Wetumpka, Alabama, to a church to participate in a funeral. And then I came home last night. I got in about 7. It was about a 900-mile round trip. I may move slower today. It's It's harder to go 900 miles and run after you get back. But I want to talk to you this morning, and I just want to challenge you with this, with these words. Be the one. Be the one. Be the one. We talk about the cross. We sing about the cross, where the blood of Jesus was shed and His blood runs down. And where sins that are dark are washed white as snow, and where new life begins, where life becomes transformed through the power of Jesus Christ, through His death, His burial, His resurrection. His resurrection power is transferred into the life of a sinner who comes to the cross in sincerity. And that life of Jesus changes everything. The funeral that I participated in is from a dear friend. She was 84. Now let me tell you the story behind that. And when I was in junior high school, I suppose, I became friends with a new girl in the class. She was not my girlfriend, she was a friend. And when God began to work in my heart and my pastor began to teach me, as a Christian, somewhere in there I realized that if I know Christ, I need to help others to know Christ. Because it is true, there is one heaven and there is a hell. And without the life of Christ in you, without the forgiveness that the cross brought for you, every person on earth is not destined for heaven. The world wants to make it like everybody gets to heaven, but that is not true biblically. And it is not true in person. That would mean that Jesus died unnecessarily. That would mean that He hung on a cross and bled and His skin was torn, His bones were pierced with a nail, and He hung there and suffered, died for no reason whatsoever. There is a hell. And Jesus came to seek and to save those who are lost so that they might be reconciled to God and receive the gift of life, eternal life. And without that life, without that moment of reconciliation, without that transforming moment of the life of Jesus saving you, the grace of God, without turning to Christ and seeing Him as your Savior and accepting Him, there is no place after death for you. No one goes to heaven without Jesus' life in them. And all that's left is an eternity of lostness and separation from God and all that is good. The Bible pictures that as a lake of fire, a place of torment, a place of darkness, an empty void. And so I said all that to get to the point I shared. We were blessed this morning. We had 42 men and boys come to prayer breakfast. Thank God for the men and boys who were there. Fellas, if you forgot and didn't wake up in time, you missed a blessing. We had, you know, sometimes we run out of eggs, but I don't know who did it, Brother Eddie or Jimmy or somebody made sure we had lots of eggs and bacon, biscuits and jelly and grits and sausage and Jesus. I shared some of this story with them this morning. When I went to the funeral yesterday, I went to the funeral of Evelyn Kane. Evelyn was the mother of the girl Tony that I became friends with in high school. And our pastor challenged us if we had never led somebody to the Lord. Now, listen, I understand nobody comes to Jesus without the work of the Holy Spirit. But I also understand nobody comes to Jesus without a human being involved in the process. The angels don't witness to people. The angels tell people where to go so somebody can make known to them the way of Jesus. The angels came to Peter on the roof and said, go over to that place so you can tell them the way of the Lord. Somebody has to be the one to tell people. And so I decided, after I was saved, after I decided to make Jesus Lord of my life and follow Him as a in reality, that I wanted to be that one. I was a little disappointed 5 or 6 days later when I wasn't already that one. But I began to pray, and I began to think about friends who needed Jesus. And Tony was one of those friends that I thought about. And so I began to pray, and scared to death as a 16-year-old, I invited her to church. And surprisingly, she wanted to go. Did you know that about 65% of Americans, when they're polled, they do these numbers, they poll and they ask people, would you consider attending a church if a friend or a relative invited you? And about 65% of the church said, I would. I would go if someone would invite me. Well, I invited, she went to church, and so I'd been learning through my pastor how to share the plan of salvation and how a person can be saved. And I asked her one night after church, I said, Tony, can I tell you, would you mind if I tell you how to become a Christian? She said, sure. Now, I thought she'd make fun of me. I thought she'd like, you know, the devil puts all kind of junk. He whispers all kind of junk in your ear to keep you, to make you think more of yourself and how comfortable you want to be and how you don't want to sound like a fool and how you don't want nobody laughing at you. But what you need to think about is the pain of the person that's dying without Christ. And so I thought she would laugh at me. She said, no, please do. And so I took my little Bible. I went through the scriptures. I read those. And I'm going to share those with you in a moment. And when I got through, scared to death, I said, wow, she let me, in my mind this is going on. She let me tell her this gospel. I got to ask her now. And Do I ask her the question? Do I not ask her let me ask her the question. Tony, do you want to be saved? Yes, I do. And she did. And right there in the car, she accepted Christ. And here's what I want you to know. She asked me to come share it in her house with her mother, her little brother Greg, and her young brother Temple. I don't remember exactly how old they were. I'm assuming Greg was 11 or 12 and Temple was 5 or 6. And I did. And Greg wanted to accept Christ. And he did. And it wasn't long until Tony led her mom to accept Christ. Now, I don't know, perhaps her mom at some point in history, way back in her life, had prayed a prayer. Maybe she had heard the gospel in Bible school and she had said, yes, Jesus, but nothing ever changed really important in her life. She'd had a hard life. She'd made some bad decisions. How many of you have never made a bad decision? Yeah, you never made a bad decision. Right. Well, she made some bad decisions. She'd had several marriages. Tony led her to the Lord, and when that happened, when Mama got saved, there was no daddy around. When Mama got saved, everything in that household was elevated and began to improve. It wasn't long till Evelyn was at the church singing in the choir. It wasn't long till soon all three of the kids were in church at Sunday school listening to the Word of God being preached. And the Word of God began to change their lives. And so yesterday when I went to this funeral for Evelyn, I thought about how those changes affected their lives. And I thought about the church that I went to. It was a lot like this building here, a little bigger. Evelyn had married a few years later to a Christian man, and there she and he began to walk with God and serve God together. They got connected in a church. They got connected in a small Baptist church that fought every other year, that had arguments all the time, that ran preachers off, and they said, you know what? God's got something better than church fighting. How many of y'all know God's got something better than church fighting? Amen? I'm glad we don't fight. If we disagree, we go back and pray some more until God makes our hearts knit together. So they started a Bible study in their home, and people started coming. Pretty soon that Bible study grew so much you couldn't get everybody in the house. So they rented a little place, found a place in Wetumpka, an old garage that hadn't been used in forever, that was filthy and dirty, and they went down in the basement of that garage and cleaned it up on that concrete, got the grease off and all of that, cleaned it up and built a little stage. And they invited me to come over about a year after they started this church and preach for them, and I went. There's 200 people in the building, standing room only, and 90 of them were teenagers. I eventually moved out of the town, and that church grew to be over 600. All because Tony said, yes. Yes, I want to accept Christ. And yes, I want to take that to my mother. And yes, I want to take that to my brother. Yes, I want to take Christ to other people. And so I walked in yesterday. I'd not seen Greg in, the Lord knows, probably 45 years. I didn't know if I'd recognize him. And honestly, I didn't. I'm still seeing him as a 12-year-old, and he's about a 55-year-old. But he came and found me and hugged me, and he turned and introduced his wife to me, and here's what he said. He said, this is the man that brought Christ to our home. Folks, I've had trophies. I've had accolades. I've had my picture in the paper. I've been the most valuable this. Sports awards. Had the highest grades and graduate. Whatever the highest honor is, summa cum laude or magna cum laude, I don't know, I don't care. Had my name at the top and everywhere else in a lot of things. Nothing in my 65 years of living has meant more to me than those few words that that man said yesterday that I hadn't seen in almost 50 years. This is the man that brought Jesus to our house. I'm not saying that to point to me. I'm saying that to point to him. I was a 16-year-old skinny football player that didn't know anything about anything, hadn't ever been anywhere and done much of anything. And God used me. The Bible says if you're going to boast, boast in the Lord. And so I'm boasting in Jesus this morning of the power of God. And so I want to challenge you with three critical decisions. I look back in my life and I think of three decisions that God led me to make that now 50 years later, this person said this to me. Number one, these critical decisions that are going to determine who you become and who you are if you live to be my age, three critical decisions. Number one, the decision to accept Jesus Christ as my Savior and my Lord. I'm going to give you some scripture verses, and I'm going to share with you how you can take this and follow this path, and you'll be able to take these verses, and you yourself, if you have not this morning, there's the most critical point in your life that will mean more than all the accolades and accomplishments on this earth. At some point, you and I come to death. And when our bodies are in that casket, or our ashes are in the urn, or when the ocean swallows us up, or however our bodies cease to be on this earth, our spiritual being, the part of us that is who we are, that's not what we look like, but is who we are, that part is going to go before us, after us, and that part of us will still be alive, and that part of us will stand before God, and we will give an account to Him. And Jesus came to die for us so that He could give us spiritual life and forgive our sins and bring us into God's family. But that doesn't happen by osmosis. It does not happen because you come to church. It does not happen because your mom and daddy are Christians. It does not happen because you do more good than evil in your life. It happens because there's a place and a time when you make the decision to accept Jesus Christ as your Savior. Here's the scriptures. If I were you, I would write these scriptures down. And I would learn them. I would write them in my Bible. So if I had somebody that asked me, how can I be saved? I could take these scriptures and let them read through these scriptures. And then I could ask them the question, do you believe this about Jesus? And they could pray to receive Christ. John 10:10. The thief only comes to steal, to kill, to destroy. The devil comes to steal all the good out of our lives. He will promise you good things, and at the end of the day, when the race is run, he'll suck everything good out of your life. He steals and then kills and then destroys forever. But Jesus said, I have come that they may have life and that they may have it more abundantly. Listen, if the rain gets loud, I'm going to get louder. Okay? Hang with me. Jesus came so that we could have life, the full life, have it abundantly. The picture, the literal words there is the picture of a flow well, of an artesian well that bubbles up, that shoots out of the ground. 83, when I was at Ebenezer, or 1980, I guess, someone had drilled an artesian well there for the church. It went 2,100 feet deep. And you could go out and open up a nozzle and turn that thing full blast, and the pressure from under the ground would shoot it out from here to the first row. Houses, dairy farms were run off of it a mile away. And Jesus said, the life that I want to give you, eternal life, will last forever in eternity. And when you die, you won't really be dead. You'll be with my Father in heaven. But not just there. I want to give you this kind of overflowing, full and abundant life. Jesus wants to give us the kind of life that elevates us and lifts us. Romans 3:23. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. God's original plan, His target for your life and mine, like an arrow shot at that target, all of us have fallen short. I want to ask you a question. In the big picture, I'm not talking about if you're in a competition event. But if you miss the mark, does it really matter how close you got? You missed. Some people go to church. Some people try to do good works. They try to be nice to everybody, even people who don't deserve nice people. And they try to earn their way in God's favor. And the Bible says that it's not by our works and our good deeds that we are saved, but it is by the grace of God through faith. All have sinned. All are sinners. And as such, all are separated from the life of God. And if you die in the state of being a sinner separated from God's life, you will be separated from God throughout eternity. Romans 6:23. The wages of sin is death. When I was 7 years old, I picked butter beans and sold them for $3 a bushel. Now, if God made me do that again, I would, but I hope He never makes me do that again. Some of you did worse than that. But when you work and you are compensated for your work, you get what? You get wages. You get a paycheck. And so the paycheck for sin is death. Physical death, spiritual death. But listen, the free gift of God is eternal life in Jesus Christ our Lord. If you stand before God and get the wages you earn, and I stand the ones I get that I earn through my works, God will say, depart from me, I never knew you. But if you come to Christ and accept Him as your Savior, God will say, come into the kingdom that is prepared for you. Romans 5:8. God demonstrated His love for us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. So this is a time you can look at each other. And kids, some of you sitting here, this is a good time to tell your neighbor, Jesus Christ died for you. Try that. It feels good. See, you've already witnessed this morning. It's not so hard. Romans 10. 9 and 10. How do I come to Christ? Well, first, if I confess with my mouth the Lord Jesus, that means if I submit my life to God and I accept Jesus as the Lord of my life, and I believe in my heart that God raised Him from the dead, that He died for my sins and God raised Him, you will be saved. Romans 10:13. Whoever calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. And so I ask people to pray with me. And I tell them, you ask Jesus to be your Lord and Savior. And way back 50 years ago, 49 years ago, sitting in a 57 Chevrolet outside her mama's house, coming home from church, Tony Morrison called on the name of the Lord and took that to her family. And they were saved. Decide to accept Christ as my Savior and Lord. Number two. Decide to give Jesus first place in everything in your life. As an operational principle. I want to ask you a question. What do you make first place in your life? Is it your family? Is it your fun? Is it football? Is it boating? Is it fishing? Is it work? Is it your children? Is it your grandchildren? Is it your husband or your wife? All of those can be good things unless they are one thing that is above the rule of Jesus. Jesus said, you cannot be my disciple unless you love me in such a way that your love for your own family and your own life appears to be hate. The Bible says of Jesus, 2 Peter 3:15, says of Jesus, I know you're going to put it up there. And I could have written down the wrong verse for him. That absolutely is not the verse. I said second, it is first, Peter. I apologize. Even after you get saved, you make mistakes. He says, but sanctify the Lord God in your hearts. Another translation of that says, set apart Jesus as Lord in your heart. Always be ready to give a defense to anyone that asks you for a reason, the hope that's in you, and do it with meekness and fear. Romans 14, 9. To this end, Christ died and rose and lived again. And most of us would think if we just stopped right there and we had ... and you had to fill in the blank, you'd say to save souls. Isn't that right? Didn't Jesus say, I came to seek and save the lost? Yes. But seeking and saving the lost was a part of a larger purpose of God. Christ died and rose from the grave and lived again in order that he might be Lord of both the living and the dead. I was 15 years old. I had accepted Christ. I had finally began at 14 to read the Bible for myself. And I began to pray and I began to ask God to help me to grow. I learned a lot of that at youth camp. We had some fun activities at youth camp, but fun wasn't the main thing. Jesus was the main diet. And there, one night, at Camp Ada, near Pensacola, Florida, at 15, Jesus was my Savior, but I was struggling with my friends who drew me toward the world. And I had a foot out there. And I had a foot over here. And if I'd had a third foot, it would have been here with self-glorification to make my name in athletics big. And as I began to understand that Jesus died, that he might have first place in life, listen, I remember saying to him, Lord Jesus, you died for me. You gave your life for me. The least I can do is live for you. Have you as a Christian come to the point where you have decided to follow Jesus? You were saved, but I'm asking you, is Jesus Christ, does he have first place of everything in your life? And is he first in your life? Step two of being the one is to make Jesus Lord of your operational daily life. Step three. First step, step one, accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior. Step two, decide as a functional reality to make Jesus, give him first place in your life. To no longer give athletics first place in your life. No longer give your friends' opinion of you first place in your life. No longer give your family first place in your life. Give Jesus first place in your life. And if he's first place, he has the right to say, back off of this. And if he's first place, he'll make you a better family member. If Jesus is first place, you'll be a better husband. You'll be a better wife. because you'll be receiving from Him instructions that will teach you how to love people in the way they ought to be loved. Number three, be the one, make the decision to be the one who leads others to the only one who can transform lives. The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, gentleness, and goodness. Self-control. Against these there's no law. That's the fruit of the Spirit in our lives. But the fruit of a Christian, when God created the earth, He created the earth in such a way that everything brought forth fruit after its own kind. That means sheep make sheep. Goats make goats. The fruit of a Christian life is another Christian. Jesus said to His disciples, if you abide and remain in Me, and My word abides and remains in you, then you will bring forth much fruit that will remain. Apart from Me, you can do nothing. Some of us here this morning need to make the decision that whatever time God has given me, if I'm old and I think I've only got a little bit of time, you don't know how much time you've got. God controls that. If I'm young and I think I've got a lot of time, whatever time I have left in my life, I want to be the one who leads other people to know the only one who can give them spiritual eternal life and transform and lift and elevate their families. And if Jesus is Lord in my life, then He's Lord over my fears. And I'll obey Him no matter how much I don't want. I don't want to be thought to be a fool. Romans 1:16 says this, hear me. I am not ashamed of the gospel. Would you be ashamed to share the gospel with anybody on earth? To be ashamed of the gospel is to be ashamed of the God and the good news of Jesus. I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. It is the power of God unto salvation for everyone who believes, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. The gospel is not about how you share it. So people are so afraid they're going to make a mistake in sharing the gospel. Listen, just tell it. Read those scriptures and ask them, does this make sense to you? Would you like to accept Christ? Tell it. You can't mess it up. It is not you who saves. It is not me who saves. It is Christ who saves. And there is power. There is supernatural power that when the gospel is shared, the supernatural Holy Spirit power of God is there to bring conviction and draw people to Christ. Tony Long, Toni Morrison did not accept Christ because I'm a powerful person. She accepted Christ because He is powerful and His gospel has power in itself to get people's attention and to speak to their minds and draw their hearts so that they want to submit their life to Him. 1 Corinthians 9. 1 Corinthians 9. This is what Paul said. My last scripture. For though I am free from all men, I have made myself a servant to all. If you want to be the one, here's Paul's telling you how. If you want your life to count in eternity, Paul's telling you how. I made myself a servant to all in order that I might, what? Win more. And to the Jews, I became like a Jew that I might win the Jews. To those who are under the law, I became like somebody under the law. I know I'm not under the Jewish law, but I became a person who accepted the restrictions of the Jewish law so that I might witness to those who are under the Jewish law and I might win those who are under the law. To those who are without the law, I became as one without the law. Back up. Not being without the law toward God, but under the law toward Christ, so that I might win those who are without the law. Okay? To the weak, I became like the weak, that I might win the weak. I became all things to all men, to all people, that I might by all means save some. Three decisions to accept Christ as my Savior. Number two, decide to bring my life fully, as much as I know how, under the Lordship of Christ in my operational. Have you made Christ Lord in your daily operational life? Wife, husband, people argue and fight over prideful stuff. Who's right? Who's wrong? What difference does it make when both of us bow our knee to Christ? He is right. Decide to give Jesus first place daily in your life. Number three, decide to be the one who leads others to the only one who can transform their life. The first people I prayed for to be saved, I didn't lead them to the Lord, but I prayed for them. That's a good place to start. Identify a person that's lost, that's a friend of yours, that's a family member, and commit yourself daily to pray. Write their name down in the Bible or whatever you use daily. I hope it's the Bible you use daily. Write it down somewhere so that you're reminded every day to pray for that person to be saved. Another pastor, I was a teenager, led people to Christ. Praise God. Doesn't matter what servant leads a person. It matters that they get there. Be the one. Commit yourself to be the one who leads others to Christ. If you've never, hear me, if you've never led, if you're a Christian, if you're a Christ follower, and you've never had the privilege of leading another person through targeting them for your prayers and praying for God to give you an opportunity to share Christ with them. If you've never done that and had the opportunity to say, can I share with you? It's real simple. Y'all make it complicated. Has anyone ever told you how to be saved? I care about you and I want you to know my God. Can I take a few minutes to tell you? Then read those scriptures and ask them if they want to accept Christ. Pretty simple. If you've never done that, will you commit yourself today and say, God, I want, before I die, to lead one person. I want to personally lead at least one person to the Lord. And I guarantee you, if you do, you will not just lead one person, but a fire will get a hold of you, and you'll lead others. Be the one who leads others to the only one who can transform lives. Pray with me. The team's going to come and sing. We're giving an invitation. I want to be very specific. I mean, we will receive you to come and pray. We'll receive you to come and share burdens. We'll have someone here to pray with you about this burden and that burden. But I'm specific in my invitation. If you've never accepted Christ as your Savior, what keeps you from doing that today? Get up out of your seat when we start to sing and come here to the front to me or Dave and say, I give my life to Jesus. I want Him to be my Savior today. Number two, if you're a Christian, you walk with God, but you realize that Jesus, though He is Lord, He is not the functional operating Lord in your life. Would you come this day and say, if Jesus loved me enough to die for me, the least I can do is live fully for Him. I give Him the right. Here and now, I enthrone Him as the Lord of my life. Number three, will you commit yourself to be the one that through God's help and the power of the Spirit that leads another one to Jesus. Father, I give you all the glory and all the praise. I'm astounded and I'm amazed that you can use a wretched person like me. And I'm amazed at the power that you can take a woman who's been through 3 mad marriages, and when she comes to Christ, give her a hope and a future, and use her and another her husband to start a church to reach hundreds and even thousands of people with the gospel. But you can. And I pray you'd speak to hearts this morning and call people to say, I want to be the one. In Jesus' name, amen. There is something about a public commitment that solidifies things in our heart. What is God saying to you? And will you publicly commit yourself this morning to follow him? Stand, sing, you respond. Thank you for being here. That's pretty heavy stuff, isn't it? Do you know the difference between heaven and hell, how far it is apart? Anybody know how far it is from heaven to hell? It's the distance. It's about 18 inches from knowing Christ here and knowing him here. Make sure you know him here and that he's Lord of your life. And ask God to use you to reach others. I'm astounded. I was blown completely away yesterday when that guy said that. And it is a privilege. It is a privilege that any Christian can have to take Christ into the homes and families of other people. So ask God if he'll use you. We want to be dismissed in prayer. Don't forget, We have Kathy, your group's going to meet over here with you, the volunteers for the banquet. We have the table for Restoration House out in the left in the foyer. We have on the table in the foyer a place for you to sign up to help put out chairs once a month. We need four teams, maybe actually 4.3 teams, but four teams once a month. You'll get to help put out chairs and leave the burden, actually become more than a consumer, become someone who takes responsibility to help make what happens in here happen. Thank you. Let's be dismissed in prayer. Lord God, you're good. We love you. We give you all the glory, all the honor, and all the praise for all that you've done and all that you're doing. And we pray, Lord, as we go today, that you will bless our folks, that you'll be with those who are sick, with Ms. Nancy Johnson, God, with this child that has cancer, or this young lady. We pray for your mercy in their lives. And thank you for the privilege, for all of us who know you, we have, Lord, of being your representative in this lost world. Use us far beyond what we could possibly believe that you're able to do. In Jesus' name, amen.